No? No. Okay. Give up, huh? Okay. You wish? Yeah, tell me.
Yeah, when this gambling was going on based on Draupadi and Dharma, Yudhishthira has lost Draupadi. Okay. Like Bhima loses his temperament and he praises Draupadi. She was such a pressure to all of us and you have lost her. At that point of time, he praises Draupadi.
What does he say?
He says she is the pressure from the Dhrupada Nadu from where she comes from. And she is like a friend to us, she is like a mother to us. She was the light of our lives and we have lost her.
Does he say this in the court?
I think so.
To add on to that, yes, he just says that they're accusing Yudhishthira. He says, Madhar Kula Virakai Andhe Vaila Vadi Vadagai. He goes about praising Draupadi.
This is Vili Bharat or Vili Bharat?
No.
The original Vyasa Bharat.
Tamil version of Mahabharata.
The Tamil version, translation.
Yes.
From the original.
Panchayi Sabha.
Yeah, okay, great. That's what I wanted. Yeah, go on, continue.
Okay. He goes about appreciating Draupadi for her qualities, characters, and even her heritage, and then says, you lost her in a game of gambling. It's more of an accusation of his brother, but he also appreciates Draupadi.
Okay. Great. Okay, the Pandavas always had respect for Draupadi, but unfortunately, Yudhishthira, he was forced to pledge her. But I'm not going to take that episode. I'm going to take this episode where Yudhishthira himself praises Draupadi. See, it is customary, sampradaya, as well as tradition that you know a husband never praises his wife in public. Privately, you praise Padamata, that's where you know. In public, you are not supposed to praise because, you know, it's generally like praising yourself. Wife and husband are considered as the same entity for that matter. That is Ardhana Arishwara Swarupa. Every man has a woman in her, a woman in him, and every woman has a man in her. So both of them are considered to be the same. So if you kind of appreciate your wife in public, it means you're appreciating yourself. But Yudhishthira did that on Draupadi on one occasion. Which occasion? Generally, we have this feeling that Draupadi is a kind of an embodiment of vengeance, that attitude of revenge. Draupadi nale pali vaangra and embodiment. That is what we generally feature, no? We visualize Draupadi as full of that vengeance attitude. It's not like that. After the Mahabharata war, after the Pandavas had won the war, when they were sleeping peacefully after so many days, in fact so many months and years together, the sons of Draupadi, the five sons of Draupadi, sons of the Pandavas, born to Draupadi, they were also sleeping peacefully. Ashwatthama had vowed to kill all the Pandavas. And assuming these five sons of Draupadi to be Pandavas, he chopped off the heads of these sons of Draupadi while they were sleeping. Just imagine. Draupadi gets up in the morning. She's horrified to see all her five children are dead. Heads are rolling in one corner. She cries at the top of her voice. Arjuna comes running. Arjuna says, this is in the Bhagavad Puran, okay? Arjuna says, don't worry Draupadi, I will come back with the head of the killer. He comes back with Ashwatthama. He just pulls Ashwatthama into the court. And there Draupadi says, Sa Muncha Muncha, release him. Release him first, she says. Why? Arjuna looks shocked at Draupadi. She says, he is the son of Dronacharya who is our guru. The son of our guru should be considered as the guru himself. Son of a preceptor is the preceptor himself. So we have to give him the honor that we ought to give Dronacharya. Release him, let him go. if she had been that epitome of vengeance and revenge, do you think she would have said these words? She is an embodiment of compassion. And at this point, Yudhishthira, Dharmaputra says, Draupadi, you are a repository of compassion. That one sentence from Yudhishthira was enough for her. Because Yudhishthira never praised anybody for that matter. He was Dharmaputra, no? Embodiment of Dharma. One of the important things of Dharma, principles of Dharma, is you should not flatter anybody just for flatteries. Unless it's wholehearted, you should not talk even a single word of praise. That's why all these saints, no, they say, I won't do Narasthuti. Even if he's a king who has contributed crores towards building a temple or towards digging a lake, they say, I won't do Narasthuti. I will do only Haristuti. Yudhishthira says this. You know why? Because of her last words. What were her last words? Draupadi says, I have lost my 5 sons and only I know the Matra Bhava, the Putra Shoka of a mother losing a child. If Ashwatthama is also killed, then Ashwatthama's mother will also be put to the same state as mine. I don't want her to suffer like me, she said. Let it be over with my suffering. Let not another woman continue to have the same pangs of suffering as mine. That was it. Yudhishthira said, clapped. He said, wow, Draupadi, such a compassionate heart you have. Draupadi was a very dynamic person. That does not mean that she was very greedy or she wanted everything in the world. She guarded the Pandavas to go for Yuddha. Because that was their dharma. Again, the concept is around dharma. She was a Kshatriya princess. She wanted the Pandavas to go for war because that was their dharma. Heroism was their dharma of those Kshatriyas. See, if a good man does not become rich and a wrong man becomes rich, then what is going to happen in this world? Is the whole world will be tormented and tortured by that wrong man. I put it down. A good man passes through that. He says, why the Patruva? He goes off. Another man walks by. Oh, Patruva, that wrong man takes that 10 rupees. If that good man had taken that 10 rupee more, and given it to a poor man, that wrong man would not have taken that 10 rupee note. This is the philosophy of Krishna. Krishna says, Arjuna, if you don't go for battle now, if you don't catch hold of Hastinapura now, if you don't rule Hastinapura, then what will happen? All the wealth, all the riches will go to Duryodhana. It's like all the riches going to Osama bin Laden. Imagine, another 2 buildings will come down. That is what is going to happen, no? So if Duryodhana has all the riches, he's only going to do more and more harm to the world. So, Krishna says, Dharma Dhyuddhashreya. Your prosperity lies in fighting for Dharma. You fight for Dharma. That was why Draupadi urged the Pandavas to go for Yuddha. You understand Draupadi's concept? Doesn't mean that she was always full of vengeance and revenge. She was so full of compassion. She was never greedy. In fact, after this, I took up this light. Make it a little smaller. It's blurred because of the lighter. Switch off the light. I took up this slide, you know why? After this attempt to disrobe Draupadi, Krishna saved her. Switch off the light. Yeah, it's better. After this episode, after they tried to disrobe Draupadi and after Krishna saved her, Dhritarashtra did not know what to do. Ayyo, Krishna kapatitare. That was his situation. Now what will he do? Maybe Draupadi would curse the Kauravas and put the dynasty to a zero. What if Draupadi curses the Kauravas and brings the Kaurava dynasty to zero? What will happen? So he calls Draupadi, Draupadi come in. Of all my daughters-in-law, you know something? Draupadi, you are my most favorite daughter-in-law. He says this after all the mental trauma she's faced till now. Then he says, you ask boons. I will give you boons. Ask the first boon. Draupadi says, as the first boon, I want you to release Yudhishthira, who is the follower of Dharma. She does not criticize the Pandavas. Just note this point. She does not criticize the Pandavas even for a single second at the court. She just asks one question. Did Yudhishthira lose himself and then me? Or did he lose me first and then himself? That was the only question she asked. She did not criticize them. That is not the subject for today's topic also. What I wanted to tell you is, she asks the first boon, let Yudhishthira be released. Then Dhritarashtra says, yes, I release Yudhishthira, ask for the second boon. She says, let the other four Pandavas also, along with their chariots and weapons, let them be released. And Dhritarashtra says, yes, I release them all. You ask for the third boon. I give you all the property back, all the belts, all the Indraprastha back. She could have asked. She did not. She said, these two boons are enough for me. I don't want a third boon at all. Greed will cause only adharma. I have confidence in my husband. They will earn their property back through heroism. At that point, Karna, who disliked Draupadi throughout his life, he said, wow, what an amazing lady. Karna praised. You know something? Great men on great women, this topic, it's very easy for great women who like those great men, who like those women, to praise those women. Great men who did not like those women should praise that woman. Only then it's a right kind of a praise. Yaarukku unna kanna pudikave illayo avukitta irundhu unakku wow, that was great. In that, if you get that kind of a praise, then that means that you have really done something good. No? That kind of a praise Draupadi got from Karna. That's why I took this slide. The next one. Bhagavad Puran. Next slide. So I just recap till now what I was doing. Maybe somebody can do that. Why should I? Recap till now what we did. Vedikesh. Gargi. Ramayana. Sita. Dharma. The telegraph Maria the sentence. Okay. Next, Mahabharat, Draupadi. At least whom are who Silalamit? Karna and Draupadi, Yudhishthira and Draupadi, Rama and Sita, Vivekananda and Sita, Yagyavakya and Maitri, on Gargi, Dasharatha and Kausalya. Great. Okay. Next, Bhagavad Desai, this is my favorite because I think this is the ultimate. Greatest man on the greatest women, I would like to give this heading. Because the greatest man, if you could call him a man, would be Krishna. Because he was a versatile person, many-sided. You cannot imagine a person like Krishna at all. He was the best householder with the best sannyasi. He was the richest, he was the poorest. He was the naughtiest, he was the most dharmic. Now, oxymoronic qualities, no? Such a person you can never imagine. He had everything in him. Still, he did not want to have the throne. He had the Mathura Samrajya, he had the Dwaraka Samrajya, he won Narakasura, he made Bhima win over Jarasandha, he released 20,000 kings, all these kingdoms he could have annexed to his property. Onnu kuda eduthilla Mathura imeda tharula Dwaraka imeda Prasena tharu Narakasura he won. He gave the property to Narakasura's son. Nallavana ennatti unga appa mari onne kodapidu. That was his philosophy. Now very charming, very lively, very active, very heroic, very smiling, very loving, very caring, very bold, everything. There could be no other person like Krishna. And Krishna says, more than me, there is somebody in this world who is greater than me. I mean, now nobody else. He says, no, Dhruva, there is somebody greater than me. Talks to his friend Uddhava, his minister, his counselor. Who can be greater than you? That is. Who can be? Who can it be? He says, the gopis of Vrindavan. Gopis of Vrindavan. What's so great about them? Uddhava says. And he says, sometimes, this is better. Let it be silent. Because this point needs silence. He says, sometimes you realize the greatness not by lecture, but by experience. So he does not give a lecture on the gopis. He does not make Uddhava sit down on one of the chairs and say, Uddhava, a lecture about gopis. They were so great, they had this quality, they had this quality, they had that quality. No. He says, you go to Vrindavan. Go to Vrindavan. Salaswana Bhava Vedyave. You will experience that bliss of love. That absolute love. So Uddhava goes to Vrindavan. And he's seen many great women in Mathura. So he thought, what's going to be so great about them? I've seen all great women, all very fashionable women in Mathura. All big, great women achievers. So there's nothing extraordinary that I'm going to see. And after all, these gopis are uneducated, illiterate shepherd women. They were just grazing cows, no? After all, what is it that I, such an intellectual man, could learn from those uneducated, illiterate women? So that was his attitude. He went to Vrindavan. The gopis, for a minute, they thought it was Krishna himself. Because for gopis, everything was Krishna. And Uddhava was wearing Krishna Prasad. He was wearing Krishna's Pitambar, Krishna's garland, Krishna's kundala. Because Krishna had gifted all his things to his friend. So he was wearing everything. So for a minute, gopis thought it to be Uddhava and then thought it to be Krishna. They ran towards Uddhava and then they realized that it was not Krishna. Then they spoke to a bee. A bee. B-E-E-B. That bee, that is a great stuti, Brahmar stuti, in Bhagavad, where you think they are uneducated, illiterate women folk, right? Even the biggest commentators are not able to write interpretations and commentaries fully for that Brahmar stuti. They meant Uddhav and Krishna at the same time, looking at the bee. So every shloka that they said, it's in Sanskrit, every sentence they spoke about the bee, they spoke about Uddhav, they spoke about Krishna. Then Uddhav spoke. Uddhav was just listening. He wanted to speak a lot. He wanted to convince the gopis that Krishna will come someday. They need not cry and make such a fuss. He wanted to talk a lot. But he just was listening. There was nothing to talk there. He was just listening. He was amazed at the gopis' wisdom. And then the gopis were convinced that he was definitely Krishna's friend. So they became very closely associated with Uddhava. They took Uddhava to all their houses. Showed him how Krishna used to play with him and all that. Months together, Uddhav spent at the gopis' place. Finally, he came back to Krishna. Krishna asked, can you tell me Now about the gopis and the greatness. Uddhav cried and he said, Krishna, I am no man to speak on the gopis' praying, but I just feel you are wasting your time at Dwarka and Mathura here. Let's go back to Vrindavan. That was his word. That was just his word. What do you understand from this? I thought I could understand only one thing. Everybody says the end of education is character. No? I feel the end of education is pure love. Ultimate love for love's sake. Love for love's sake is what the gopis taught the whole world. And after that, so many people have praised the gopis. Narad ji, the Bhakti Sutra Granta Katta, the author of Bhakti Sutra, he says, I'm such a great sage. I'm a Devarishi. I know everything. I'm intellectually so high, totally wise. But you know what? You know how I've learned all this? You know how I've learned how to be devoted? You know how I've learned what devotion is? Yatha Braja Gopikana. By paying my prospects, by paying my respects to Braja Gopis. You may think that they were just shepherd women, but according to me, they were not just shepherd women. They were embodiments of pure love. And if that pure love persists in this world, all the faults will get drowned in that pure love. That is what they taught us. உனக்கு உன்னை டாலரேட் பண்ண முடியலையா சப்போஸ் somebody else is shouting at you. You are not able to tolerate. You shout back. Why? Because you don't love that person so much. Everything, the solution lies in love. You are not able to be patient with somebody. Why? That love is missing. The solution to all problems in this life is love for love's sake. And that was taught by the gopis. And that lesson, Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita, I learnt it from the gopis. Krishna Nande Jagat Guru. Krishna is the guru of all gurus. He says, the gopikas are my teacher. I have learnt it from those women. So education does not mean reading books and books and books and books and books and books, and books. Go on scraping to the pages. Does not mean that. I'm highly educated. What does that mean? Oru naalai kuda samachi saapadu poda maata. That is the conclusion. Nowadays, if you are educated, if you are highly educated, that means that you are highly arrogant. You are highly proud. The more your degree, MS, double MS, PhD, arrogance level, you know, directly proportional. But how should an educated woman behave? If you are really educated, you must have the comprehensive ability to understand the other person's ideas and views. If you are really educated, you must have that listening ear. Knowledge will speak, but wisdom will listen. Knowledge will only speak, but wisdom will listen. If you are wise enough, you will have that listening ear. If today's modern women are really educated in that real sense, why are they behaving arrogantly? Why are they proud? Why are there so many divorces? Why is the rate going on so much? Why are women not able to maintain even a small family? Already is an atomic nuclear family. Still they are not being able to be happy. Why? Because love for love's sake. That pure, unconditional, indisputable love has gone. So, the greatest man and greatest woman, that was Krishna on gopis. Next slide. So I think I would like to conclude this session now. There have been many turning points for many great men. That's Shanta Devi. Vivekananda considered her, everybody considered her as the Divine Mother. Divine Mother had many disciples. Vivekananda wanted to open a women's hostel, women's education center, the very first time. The Velur Math was discussing this. And then one of the disciples said, "Don't do that. Women's education? No, don't do that." He said, "No, even in the Vedic era, women were educated. Ramayana era, women were educated. Mahabharata era, women were educated." And then what happened after the Mahabharata era, after the Bhagavad, during the Islamic rule, invasion, during the Britishers' rule, the whole scenario in India, it collapsed. We are going back into history. That's why I told you the beginning. You need to know Indian history properly. What happened was Akbar issued a diktat. For an example I'm giving you. Akbar issued a diktat. Any woman on the street not wearing a purdha. Any woman on the bazaar or on the street not wearing a purdha has to go into the house of the prostitute. That was a diktat issued. It was made an act. That was the kind of rigidity they imposed on the men. So the whole scenario, because of Muslim invasions of Britishers, everything changed. So then slowly all their customs is women should not be educated, they don't have rights to voice their opinion. All those are equally Western opinions too. You would have heard about all these Western movements, feminist movements. You know how they started? Because this West had this idea that women should never be educated, women should not get the voting rights, women should never have the right of expression. All these were the ideas of the West. That's why these Western feminist movements started. India never had this problem. I told you, right from the Vedic era, we moved till now. Did we see this problem? No. We only saw very dynamic people, very well-mannered ladies, very well-educated people, everywhere. And there was no caste barrier also. Because in Ramayana, you can see Matanga Muniva. Matanga Rishi teaching Shabari, a tribal woman. A woman in the first place, second place an outcast. So there was no caste barrier to education. There was no creed barrier, there was no gender bias, nothing. This suddenly started because of the invasions into India. That was when women were treated differently. And then that line of degradation continued very, very, very gradually, but at an equal speed, such that, say 50 years back, when Bharatiya's times, he had to sing about Pen Vidudale. I got songs of Bharatiya, but I don't think I have time now. He had to sing about Pen Vidudale because that was the way women were treated before independence. At Bharatiya's times, for example, see, he says all this, how women were treated during Bharatiya's times, before independence. It's shocking, but it's still the truth. Because see, he has written many poems on Penmai. There he says, "Arivu konda manitha uyirgalai, adimai aakka muyalbavar pittaram." Adimai aakka, women were treated as slaves. Adimai aakka, aanum pennum nigarana kolpadal arivu longiyavar vayyan thazhaikkumam. Let the woman be treated at par with the man. All these concepts, no? Kumiyadi thodikudu. See, I just think one. ஏட்டையும் பெண்கள் தொடுவது திமையன்றவர் மாண்டு விட்டார் வீட்டுக்குள்ளே பெண்ணை பூட்டி வைப்போம் என்ற விந்தை மனிதர் தலை கவிழ்ந்தார் குன்னி நீரடி தமிழ்நாடு முழுதுங்குள்ளும் கிட. This was in Tamil Nadu. So he says, கேட்டையும் பெண்கள் தொடுவது தீமையன். It was considered a big crime, a sin, if a woman touches it. ஏட்டையும் பெண்கள் தொடுவது தீமை என்றெண்ணி இருந்தவர் மாய்ந்து விட்டார். வீட்டுக்குள்ளே பெண்ணை பூட்டி வைப்போம் என்ற விந்தை மனிதர் தந்தார். Women used to be arrested, locked up within the doors. All they knew was those four corners of the four walls. கற்புநிலை என்று சொல்வன் சொல்ல வந்தார் இரு கட்சிக்கு அது பொதுவில் வைப்போம். Everybody used to talk about chastity, but only for women. He says, let chastity be common for man and woman together. Bharatiya views, no? Chastity is not only for a woman. You refuse. வற்புறுத்தி பெண்ணை கட்டி கொடுக்கும் வழக்கத்தை தள்ளி மீறித்திடுவோம். Don't force marriage for women. In the Vedic era, women had the equal privilege to pursue their knowledge, which is spiritual knowledge, mind you, which could guide them in the right path. So they could, if they wanted, remain unmarried and go in the path of the Brahmavadinis. That's why they were called Brahmavadini. Brahmavadi, Brahmavadini. So there are so many, you would have read about Pudumai Pet, or maybe not. So, all these and more, so many of the men have talked about women. And this problem of women liberation, Pen Vidudalai, Pudumai Pet, all that came only because of the invasion into India. India was not like that and had never been like that before. The others' opinions, when others came into India, slowly India absorbed their values. And now what is happening is total westernization of India. This is the worst period, because we are being more and more influenced by the West. Now we need to have a different kind of a vision. That is, I think, going to be the topic for the second session. The challenges faced by the modern women. Because this era is going to be a tougher and tougher era for women. Whether to balance your family, you read so much, you're so much educated, you have to take up something, some career. And some, how are you going to balance the career and your family? Can you? Or is it going to, that's going to take a lot of a toll on your health too. So what are the challenges that today's woman is going to face and in the future? That is going to be the subject for the next session. But till now, these points, these great men on great women, I just like to conclude this session with one or two points. I have read the life histories of several sages, saints throughout India. My father-in-law respected Sri Sri Anna, we call him, Sri Krishna Premi Swami. He has written a book called Vaishnavi Samhita. It's a history, life histories of all saints throughout India. I was reading throughout after my marriage for the first 2-3 years. I was gesting with that book. It was a history of all these saints. I told you, north, west, east and south. I read about Purandaridas. He was Chinnappa Nayaka first. He was utterly miser. He was a great miser. Miser to the extreme. He had 9 crores. Imagine 9 crore wealth in those times. But still he was not satisfied. He had a wife by name Lakshmi Bai. She had a heart which could beat for others. So when she saw a poor man, a hungry man, or somebody really needing medical help, her heart would beat for others. While Chinnappa Nayaka's heart would be beating for every rupee he spent. One rupee spent, you would really feel agitated. This Lakshmi Bai, somehow by her true love for love's sake, she transformed the life of Chinnappa Nayaka in Purandaras. I read that history. And then I went on to read Tulsidas' history. Then Tulsidas had gone on a pilgrimage. He was a Ram Bhakta. And it was the time of that Islamic invasion rule. So he was really bothered about his wife. His wife was very beautiful. So he had told her, don't go anywhere. I'll come back in a few months. All the provision, all the grocery, I have brought it from the shops. I've kept it in this room. I've locked it up. Don't open the door for anybody. Not even a beggar. Okay? Be careful. After the pilgrimage, he came back. His wife was not there. He was shocked. He inquired the neighborhood and somebody said she's gone to her parents' place. So he ran. Literally ran on the street. He ran to her to his in-law's place, to her parents' place. It was locked. He jumped on the wall. He jumped on the wall like a thief. And he saw that his wife was sleeping peacefully. He was really angry. He woke her up. It was 1 o'clock in the night. Who asked you to come here? He said, why? This is my father's place. My brother was not well, so today morning I got a message. He came here to take care of my brother. I was so worried, you know. And then she said, you say so much about devotion and Rama Bhakti and you talk so much of Rama and say, Apanam, Pavataram, Nataram, Sarvasampalam, Rama takes care of every person in danger. Oh, is that all just for a speech? Just for a lecture? Don't you practice it in person? Don't you practice it in your life? If you had even 1% of faith in that living God that you talk of, you wouldn't have been bothered so much. You would have been bold enough. And that one sentence from his wife was an eye-opener for Tulsidas. Then I went on to read Ramakrishna Paramahansa's life. Where Sharda Mani Devi, she got married to Ramakrishna when she was very young. But then the marriage consummated after a very long time. And somebody said, Sharda Devi, your husband is a total lunatic fellow. Paitanda. So you can't go. He is a Dakshineshwar. He is completely gone mad. So you need not go there. She was shocked. She kept on inquiring about Ramakrishna Paramahansa. Everybody said, he's gone mad, he's gone lunatic. Suddenly, one day she said, she told her father, I'm going to see Ramakrishna Paramahansa. I'm going to see my husband. I'm going to join my husband. Her father said, haven't you heard so many people saying that Ramakrishna Paramahansa is mad, completely mad? What will you do going there? Then she said, if he is really mad, it is now that he needs me. Because if he is mad, who will take care of him other than his wife, me? She had not lived even one day with Ramakrishna Paramahansa. Then she said this. Then I went on to read the stories of so many people. Jayadeva, Padmavati, Leela Sugar. I went on and on and on. And I found that in all these stories, one thing was common. What? The woman was the eye-opener for the great saint. All these great compositions from all these great Mahans, they came out of these saints because of their inspiration derived from their wife. Wife or sister or some woman. I don't agree, another it was a sister. And then I just realized how powerful a woman can be in producing even great saints and seers and sages. Not only one Shivaji Rao, heroic people. Jijabai produced Shivaji, Raja Bhosle. Not only producing heroic people, how powerful women can be in producing even great saints and seers. All these stories have that common thread that the woman has so much of power in her. And that power, if used for the good, she can build a nation. And if that nation is again good, the entire universe is focused on that one single woman. she becomes the center point. Vasudeva Kudumbakam, no? She becomes the center point for the whole universe. That is why the mother is called Jagat Janani, mother of the universe. Not mother of a single child, not mother of a family, not mother of a society, not mother of a nation, but mother of the universe. So, whether we are going to be mothers of universe or destroyers of universe totally depends on the individual power of the woman being used properly. That is up to a woman. Having read so much, still, if we want to be destructive, if we don't want to be tolerant, if we don't want to be patient, if we don't want to be good, then it's absolutely useless listening to lectures or participating in programs. So the end result is, we all should produce such a nation which can blast up the entire universe to show that so great is our nation that you have to borrow from us and not we from you. India has so much. That was what your dean was talking of. When India was suffering so much from famine, Vivekananda did not go to the West and ask funds for famine regeneration. He did not go to collect from the West. He went to the West to give, not to collect. He gave spiritual wisdom. He said, we have so much to give. Take it if you want. We are the givers. And we should realize the power in ourselves. And if we still are ignorant of our power, it just means that ignorance cannot be bliss. It's ignorance is just completely disastrous, catastrophic. So right at this, at the conclusion of this session, I would like somebody to recap right from the beginning how great men, I don't want you to tell the same thing, great men or great women. I just want you to tell how great a woman could be to inspire a man to be great. Let's conclude the session. Do you get me? How could a woman inspire a man to be great? No. இப்போதைக்கு இருக்கிற உமன்ல யாருமே கிரேட் ஆக முடியாது.
We will start, we'll make a small change of getting questions from you and she taking them. She is asking you questions and then probably you should answer them. We will have a small change in the discourse. So the question is,
can you give me some example of a great woman inspiring a man to become great? I just gave you examples, not so many examples. It could be even practical examples.
Yeah, speaking of which, great women, inspiring great men to be even more greater and being greatest, I get reminded of Sister Nivedita inspiring Subramanya Bharati. When Subramanya Bharati, being a disciple of such a greatest man, Swami Vivekananda, when Sister Nivedita met Bharati, Bharati was towards the welfare and empowerment of women and all the caste and creed people of India from not only the British and also from their own conflicts inside the society. At that point of time, Sister Nivedita realized that Bharati has to move one step ahead, that even the empowerment of women from the kitchen and coming out to the streets and to the schools and colleges was an important empowerment that has to be made in the Indian society.
Great.
So this consumption was given to Subramanya Bharati by the great women, Sister Nivedita.
Very nice. And Bharati has composed on Sister Nivedita also. By the way, he's composed a few kavita poems. Great, I wanted that kind of an example. Wonderful.
Thank you, ma'am. Before I give you an example, I just wanted to tell this. When you were giving so many instances, I just felt so naked. I felt I didn't know my history. I felt really bad about that. Though I knew my history, I just knew that in bits and pieces. So it was really inspiring for me to learn more. I was always been proud of the Indian womenhood. I've always felt this is not been properly realized by the Indian society. I just would like to quote Pondicherry mother. I'm not particularly a follower of the Mata, but when I just read a few books of Aurobindo, it took a day for me to understand a page of this book. So,
which book did you read?
Savitri? No, I just read a book called The Problem of Rebirth.
Okay.
I just wanted to know what karma and what rebirth actually is.
Great.
I just read a few pages. I tried discussing it with people, but I just felt I didn't even understand what actually it is. And when I just went back to read why he, what is so inspired him the most, it was the mother.
Exactly.
Okay, we speak of telepathy and we speak of communication. Now, he says he was able to feel the mother, even when she was 4 years old and he was fighting for the freedom of India. So I just would like to bring in mother here, and I just tried reading mother's books. They were so inspirational, and though she's not an Indian, she follows the path of an Indian woman.
Wow, great. Sandhi, not an Indian. Trying to follow Indian womanhood, exactly what is happening in the West. You know, some many foreigners are wearing saris and we are wearing pants. That is what is exactly happening. Very nice. Both examples. Very nice. Typical Indian woman, though she was not an Indian woman. Very nice example. I think men are answering better than women, no? Girls. Some answers from this side.
I think there are some students from the School of Law who are not talking, then there's something seriously wrong. They are law school students. Yeah, please get
it. Yeah. Actually, recently I came to know about Sunita Krishnan. I was inspired by her speeches, what she is doing. Like, she should be an inspiration for every woman, I'm thinking. You have asked for.
Tell them what she did.
No, she's like at 15 years of age. Because of this Indian woman, of course, I came to know Sunita Krishnan.
Okay.
One day in my presentation, at 15 years of age, she was gang raped. I came to know that, and she did not depress of her things,
she
and she became a social activist, and she told that I liked her point. That in one of her speeches, she told every man is not rapist. There are real men. There are also men who are. Good, and she thought of coming out of a act like mad, men against demand. She asked every good man.
Even a bad incident sometimes inspires you to take it up as a social cause and be a social reformer. No, yeah, like a recent Muslim girl that she was shot. Yeah, everybody. I thought you would be giving. One of the examples, like, she's inspired the whole world to fight for her cause. Though she was shot, she has the bravery, she has the courage, no? There are women, so many women.
She
said,
she has founded this Prajwala in Hyderabad. She's serving many girls.
Yeah. So bad incident can still inspire to serve, can inspire you to serve the whole nation. Because something bad has happened to you, you take it up that it should not happen for the others. That's what was the song that our inaugural invocation song, Maitreyi Bhajata, Yuddham Tyajata. Put yourself in the shoes of others. So, Spardhan, beautiful. That beautiful song was composed by Paramacharya, Kanji Paramacharya. So, that what he says is put yourself in others' shoes. So, you could serve. That was how I would mention only his brain works. The entire body does not work. He started this mission where he could serve all the students, mentally handicapped, physically handicapped. Now it's a whole huge big institution just founded by a single person with no hands, with no legs, on a wheelchair, just the head, brain alone. I spoke to him and I said, how could you do this? He said, I'm thanking God. For what? For having paralyzed you like this way? God has done injustice to you. I said, no, he said, God has done justice to me. Just imagine if my hands were working, legs are working, body is working, but the brain is not working, I would have not been able to do this. It is the other way around. So seeing the good in the bad, even in the worst, seeing the good even in the worst is something great. And you know why I took this episode? His wife, Chitra. No? She's a very close friend of mine. She has stood by him. She loved him when he was going to be an army officer. See, he lost his entire body in the last stage of the test where he had to prove himself as an army officer. He had to jump. Now that test is not there. He had to jump from one cliff from a mountain to another cliff. He fell off. There was one Chitra, one lady who loved him. Even after the whole body was paralyzed, nothing works, only the head works, she married him. That lady married him. And she's still with him. Even today. What does that show? Amazing women are still in India. Amazing women.
Good afternoon, ma'am. Like, I would like to quote about Dr. former President APJ Abdul Kalam, who, like, even in his presidential address, he quoted his mother and Dr. M. S. Subbulakshmi. And she was...
Next slide, Padu. Konjam chicken talking go. Dip the lights. I took this slide. Can you tell me why I took this slide? There is M.S. Subbulakshmi in the photo. There. Listening to Gandhi. You can't find that out? There, last one.
Technical room.
No.
Behind the spectacle.
Behind. Ah, there. Great men or great women. Gandhiji always used to ask M.S. to sing. Hari Kumaro Janaki Peed. Every prayer, every meeting, political meeting, every political meeting started with Raghupati Rao, Raja Ram and Hari Kumaro. Gandhiji in a way was inspired by MS and MS in a way was inspired by Gandhi. So both were inspirations. Now tell me. Marandu Petkar. I disturbed you, sorry. M.S. Subbulakshmi,
you were talking about
M.S. Subbulakshmi.
M.S. Subbulakshmi, though she was, she had a beautiful voice, Nightingale of India or something like that. But she made spiritualism in her singing. Like, she went into the song of what is being done, and that inspired many people.
Yeah, but how? I'm asking you, how it inspired men?
She was simple.
Yeah, that simplicity, she was inspired by Kanchi Brahmacharya for that simplicity. And her simplicity inspired all people across the globe. Yes, very true, very true. Very true. Correct.
Since we talked about on the high greatness of Sri Sri M.S. Subbulakshmi, I would like to quote a famous quote which everybody knows, what happened when Jawaharlal Nehru, who is considered the father of the modern nation, Panchi Liberty, we adore him, who said, who am I, a mere prime minister in front of this great lady? So that way...
But he said that in front of many ladies. That is different.
We know the other aspect.
We said that we were bound by his disciples.
See, that is different. But whenever we talk about MS, No, whenever we talk about MS, whenever we talk about MS, this statement always comes to a point. Poor my MIA Prime Minister in front of the Nightingale or so called. Even Sarojini Naidu, she said, I don't want to be called the Nightingale, I directly surrender my title.
That is very true.
That you cannot contradict the statement.
Yeah, what you are contradicting is the Prime Minister's post was blocked, right?
Pardon, sir?
Prime Minister's post was blocked by
MS. Who am I? A mere Prime Minister in front of this great lady.
Yeah.
We adore the beauty.
Okay, so then can we take a couple of questions? You have questions? Okay. Quickly.
Ma'am, have you made clear that whatever history that is prevailing right now in the society is a manipulated history by the Britishers?
Correct.
May I request you to suggest some of the books or some classic sources from which we can read the unmanipulated history?
Great, actually your DS into it. He's trying to write true history. Discover India, projector?
Rediscover India.
Maybe 2 or 3 months time you'll get good history books, perfect history books, don't worry.
We should read Rajiv Malhotra's. You know, 2 weeks back, Indranet, that book has been launched, Being Different.
Right now I'm reading Being Different, sir. Okay, so far I've hardly gone 4 pages.
Okay.
Complete history books.
Yeah, now we are in a project. In fact, just wait for the breaking news. In 10 minutes, I'll just make the announcement. Any other question? I'll take one last question. Yeah.
Thank you, ma'am. Macleod's theory may be true for outlook or abstract level only. All the patriotism and ethical values are not fully destroyed from ourselves. It is always there in our bloodstream, like a spark. We need some few years to place it. So, what are the strategy as an educational stream we can do for that spark to get into the flame to empower our nation as well as our becoming a Jagat Janani?
Yeah, correct. I get it. See, basically, those who are really in need of wealth, or those who are really poor, can go abroad. Whatever you do, come back to India is my policy. It's what I'm advocating. You're going there, you take citizenship, happily say, Indian citizen goes there and say, happily without a conscience, he says, from now on, I shall be a very sincere American citizen of this nation. You have to take that pledge. Do you know that? Before getting American citizenship, you have to take that. Abrina enna arthana. நான் ரொம்ப சந்தோஷமா நான் எங்க அம்மாக்கும் அப்பாக்கும் குழந்தை இல்லைன்னு ஒத்துக்கிறேன் அப்படிங்கிற மாதிரி அப்படி கான்சியஸ் யுவர் மதர் லேண்ட் இட்ஸ் லைக் யுவர் மதர் மாதிர பூமி பா தட் இஸ் யுவர் மதர் லேண்ட் ஐ அம் ஓன்லி காலிங் ஆல் அவர் இந்தியன் கிரேட் brain products, come back, you earn enough, come back to India, settle down here, work for the nation, work for India, let it become greater than America, because America is great because of our people going there, all of them want to come back, then even America would agree. See, seriously.
That's why the examples that you gave, mother or sister Nivedita, they were all not born in India, but they were born for India.
Exactly.
And that's why, you know, though now you are born in India, the appeal is you make your birth relevant for India. That's the appeal. So thank you very much. I don't want to actually, you know, propose a formal vote of thanks, because a vote of thanks, you know, it conveys that something is coming to an end. But for us here, we consider this lecture as a beginning of an initiative that we have decided to undertake with some passion. And I was mentioning that I have some breaking news. You see, I wanted to just, you know, start this initiative and make sure that this is sustainable over a period of time, and then get into this initiative, aggregated wisdom of people of such scholarly eminence. That is why I had requested Srimati Vishakha Hari to also engage. I know she is very busy with her own commitments all over the world, but in some small way, but definitely in a very deep way, engage with the pursuit that we wanted to undertake in some of the initiatives that we had. And that is why, you know, as a university, we are very honored to designate her as an honorary professor of arts and culture in the in the Department of Oriental Studies that we have started in the university. And I take so much pleasure in handing over this formal designation to Srimati Vishakha Hari as the Honorary Professor of Arts and Culture. So as I said, I don't want to do a formal vote of thanks, but then just leave the audience with some thought which she has already laid down as a foundation. She said the next topic, the way in which she has concluded, has enthused the interest level for the next election, because today it is about empowerment. And remember the statistics that she gave, you know, 55% of the first marriages end in divorce. And if still somebody has an interest, you know, 65% of the second marriages end in divorce, and then 75% of the third marriages end in divorce. That reminds me of a joke that I recently got last week. There's one American girl calls her father and says that I got married yesterday, and sorry I couldn't tell you. But then the father says, I know you are always naughty, but next time don't forget to invite me. So an empowerment without any enlightenment is useless, because we need enlightened empowerment. That is very, very important. And I'm sure the second lecture, which is going to be Challenges in Modern Times, is a type of lecture that will give an enlightened empowerment, which is very, very essential in modern times. With this, with these few words, I thank you again for having acceded to our invitation, and thank you students and faculty members for coming to this speech, and I'm sure all of you will again gather on March 12th for yet another inspiring lecture. Thank you very much. One minute, before I request Dr. Shanti to please hand over a small memento on behalf of our university. Students, please remain seated. We will just leave and then probably you can make your own departures. Please remain seated.